Discussing the third session on account opening, onboarding process, KYC mechanism and operations. This is our unit number 3. I am Kuldeep Kumar, faculty, Indian Institute of Banking Finance, Mumbai. Previously, we have also discussed this topic in session number 2. In session number 1, we have already discussed the money laundering, the purpose of money laundering, and why money laundering should be checked. Also, we have discussed various other regulatory aspects of KYC, the Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002, various clauses, and the money laundering stages and types. You might remember, we have discussed 3 stages of money laundering: placement, layering, and integration. Besides, we have discussed KYC as a tool to check money laundering and the 4 pillars of KYC policy given by Reserve Bank of India. In the first session, we have also discussed other various guidelines on KYC from Reserve Bank of India, and what are the OVDs, officially valid documents, which are the documents to be obtained for KYC purpose. The KYC is a very, very common term. Whenever you go to a branch of a bank, first of all, before opening an account, they want your KYC documents. Those documents are OVD, officially valid documents. So as you must be knowing, they want a document to identify you, also a document to confirm your address for correspondence purpose, also for other regulatory requirements. So that we have already discussed. And also we have discussed what are the documents to be taken for identification and address, proof of address, and various other guidelines. And also what banks have been instructed to do in case of migrant workers' accounts and those employees who are getting transferred from time to time from one place to another. Now, you may also remember that in session number 2 on the same topic, we have discussed certain guidelines given by Reserve Bank of India on account of a small account. When the banks have to open a small account, how they have to proceed, and certain relaxations given by Reserve Bank of India in respect of OVDs, that is officially valid documents, in respect to the low risk customers. So you must be knowing which are the low risk customers. As you know, the salaried account customers are the low risk customers. The small business purpose accounts are opened, these are the low risk customers. So for these low risk customers, Reserve Bank of India subsequently relaxed certain guidelines, looking into their hardships, the problems they were facing in opening the accounts. So these guidelines we already discussed in our session number 2. Then one important thing that Reserve Bank of India has instructed banks, the guidelines they have given, is regarding those foreign students who are undergoing studies in India. So those foreign students who are studying in India, how their accounts have been opened, what are the safeguards to be taken by the banks. These things we have already discussed in session number 2. Then we have also discussed the accounts of various entities, the company's accounts, the individual's accounts, the partnership accounts, the trust account, and any other such kind of association, society, etc. These accounts, what are the documents to be taken as part of OVD? So these things we have already discussed in detail in session number 1 and session number 2. So now we are going to start our session number 3, where we'll be discussing various other guidelines which Reserve Bank of India has given. And these guidelines are very important instruction. RBI says this is not enough for the banks to obtain the OVDs once, but not only that, after that also periodically updation of KYC is necessary. why periodically updation of KYC is necessary. The customer may change his address, customer may change his cell number, his telephone number, his other bona fide may change. So because of that, we have to continuously be in touch with our customer so that we should know our customer in a proper manner. So on ongoing due diligence, this is called due diligence, which is ongoing due diligence. How banks can do ongoing due diligence through email. They can be in touch with their customer, whether the email is there, the customer will respond, okay, that the email is okay. We can have the correspondence, we can do the correspondence with our customer through email, through letter. Suppose we are sending a letter on the available address, latest available address of the customer, and the letter returns to us. That means the customer is not staying at this address. This sends an alert that we should now go and visit whether the customer's address is correct or the customer address is not correct. If it is not correct, we have to see what steps, other steps RBI has instructed, RBI has given the guidelines on, and then we have to follow those other steps also. Now, the telephonic conversation also is one of the means we can do the ongoing due diligence. The forms, some kind of forms can be sent, the interviews we can hold with the customer, we can have the interview with the customer. Whenever the customer comes to the branch, we can discuss with him if at all any change is there, he should submit the new KYC documents. Then personal visits, very important, we can do the personal visits also. And now see, the for medium risk customers, at least for 2 years we have to do this kind of exercise, and for low risk customer, at least for every 3 year we have to do this kind of exercise of periodic updation. Now full KYC exercise after that is also important. This is one thing that for medium risk, 2 years, low risk, 3 years. You might remember we have already discussed which are the medium risk customers and which are the low risk customers. We already discussed the medium risk customers are like trusts, societies are there, these kind of charitable trusts are there. So these are the kinds of accounts. They are the medium risk accounts. And low risk, we have already just now we discussed that it is the individual account, small salary earners account, small business account, the low risk account. So for low risk, 3 years, medium risk, 2 years, ongoing due diligence has to be done. Now full KYC exercise for high risk customers, at least every 2 years has to be done. For low risk customer, it is every 10 years has to be done. And for medium risk customer, every eight years it has to be done. So what do you mean by full KYC exercise? Means we'll take a fresh photograph, we'll take a fresh address proof, all those things, just like a full KYC we do at the time of opening account, that has to be done for high risk, for medium risk, and for low risk customer at the given periodicity by Reserve Bank of India. So the nomination, you must be knowing what is the nomination. You know, when we open an account, individual account we open, even joint account we open, then always we are in a we do not know if something wrong happens to the account holder, then who will be the owner of this money. Now one thing is that the kith and kin and the family member, they have to rush to the court and take their court orders and go to the bank. It will take a lot of hardship, it will be a problematic also, time taking also, and it will also we have to spend a lot of money in that. So in that situation, what can be done? That the nomination is one facility which is provided by the Indian laws, under the Indian laws. So there are the types of accounts are single accounts, single depositors, or the joint depositors. In both, the nomination is available. In case of joint account, all the depositors together will nominate a single nominee. Mind it, in deposit accounts, the nominee has to be one individual only. A minor nominee can be represented by a person, guardian. Sometimes the nominee can be minor also, but then he has to be represented by some senior person or a guardian. The nomination can also be changed. Suppose during the lifetime, the customer wants to change the name of the nominee, he can change it. He can come to the bank, ask the bank to give the relevant form, the consent form. You can sign. If joint accounts are there, then both the joint accounters have to, joint account holders have to sign that form and submit that form for changing the new nomination. And also it can be cancelled also. Suppose they are not happy with the person, they want to change the person, name of the person or the who has been appointed as nominee earlier, they can cancel the nomination also. That facility is also there. Now, in the accounts, what are the guidelines Reserve Bank of India gives for operations? The minimum balance requirement and the charges. The minimum balance requirement and the charges is very important. It should be very transparent. The bank should in advance inform to their customers what are the charges on different kind of facilities that the banks are providing. It should not happen. The customer should not be taken aback all of a sudden. Some charges are debited to the customer's account and the customer feels aggrieved. And then again, that spate of, complaints starts. So that kind of situation should not happen. That's why RBI says that it should be very transparent and at least 1 month in advance, suppose the banks are going to change their charges. Suppose for undertaking, suppose they want certain charges, like they want to, like any, minimum balance is not maintained. So far they had not been charging anything, but they want to start charging. Minimum balance is not maintained, then they will charge 250 rupees or 300 rupees in the account. Then they should inform this rule, change of rule, 1 month in advance to their customer. Inoperative accounts, what are the inoperative accounts? Suppose the account is not at all being operated. The customer has gone out of the state, customer has got out of town, customer has gone out of the country. In that situation, the account will not be operated at all. Huh? But in case of inoperative accounts also, no penal charges should be levied in case of inoperative accounts. Some banks start charging the inoperative account, the penal charges, they start charging, debiting that amount to the account. In that situation, what happens? That at one point of time, the balance in the account comes below the minimum threshold level. And once it comes below the minimum threshold level, then starts the minimum balance penal charges also. And finally, the amount in the balance, entire amount in balance, goes to the profit and loss account of the bank. So they say in case of inoperative account, no penal charges should be levied. This is what the guidelines of the RBI is. Then the branch address on the all passbooks, the banks should ensure that the branch address is given, the telephone number is given, and the IFS code, Indian Financial System code, which is very important. In all checks, you see the all these checks, which are the multi-city CTS 2010 standard checks that you are getting from the banks. On those banks, on those checks, you are finding one IFSC. IFSC is a 11 character alphanumeric code. Huh? So that code is very important. All those things should be mentioned in the passbook itself. And banks have been instructed by RBI to issue payable at par or multi-city CTS 2010 standard checks only. And for that first time, no extra charges should be levied. These are the guidelines. Now, IFSC code, whenever you do the NEFT or fund transfer through RTGS, these are the fund transfer mechanism. If you do that, then you need the IFSC code. IFSC code is a unique code which is allotted to one particular branch. So in all checkbooks, it is mentioned, in all passbooks also, it should be mentioned. This is the guidelines of Reserve Bank of India. Now, friends, we will discuss the premature withdrawal of term deposit. The term deposit, it can be in single name also. It can be in joint name also. Suppose a term deposit is made for, say, 5 years by a single person. And unfortunately, the person needs, the customer needs the money in between, and he's not in a position to do without that money. He wants that money at any cost. So what will happen? He will go to the bank. He will request the bank, sir, please break my fixed deposit, break my term deposit, I'm not in a position to continue that deposit for 5 years. Suppose he's coming after 1 year only. Now, what happens in that situation? The bank will refund the money in total, total amount of money which has been deposited, total amount will be deposited. But in case of interest rate, suppose for 5 years, the interest rate was 8%. And now after 1 year, he's coming to for the premature payment. Then for 1 year, suppose the interest rate is 6%. So bank will not pay the 8%, the previous rate of interest. 6% only they will consider. But in most of the banks, what happens, from 6% also they will deduct certain percentage, like 1% or 0.5%. And finally, the customer will get principal amount in full total, but in interest amount, he may get 6 minus 1 is equal to 5%. So instead of getting 8% earlier, he will get 5%. I repeat, earlier the rate of interest was 8% for 5 years. For 1 year, the rate of interest is 6%. But at the time of making premature withdrawal, the bank will deduct 1% from the applicable 1 year rate of interest. That means 6 minus 1 is equal to 5. So the interest rate will be 5%. Right now, the bulk term deposits of 1 crore and above, banks may disallow such kind of deposit, which are the bulk term deposits for premature payment. Because what happens, once 1 crore and above deposit is made by the customer with the bank invests is at the same time at the available market rate. But now, all of a sudden, this much bulk deposit is being withdrawn. Bank has to rush to the market to borrow, because otherwise bank will not be able to repay. So they have to borrow from the market. In that situation, what happens? The market rate may be higher also. So sometimes, to manage their asset liability mismatch, banks are saying that more than 1 crore bulk deposit, we will not allow to be prematurely withdrawn. Now, repayment of term or fixed deposits in joint names. Banks can open the term deposit not only in single name, it can be opened in joint name also. So if the deposit is opened in joint names, both the depositors jointly have to sign the document. If at all this deposit is to be repaid prematurely, then there can be a mandate EOS or S, that is either or survivor mandate. Means the jointly Mr. A and Mr. B, these two individuals have opened an account jointly, term deposit with the bank. But now, after sometimes they may go to the bank for premature withdrawal also, they may take the payment on maturity also. If on maturity they are taking the payment, it is either or survivor mandate, then anybody of them, either of them can take the payment, either first number or second number, either of them can take the payment of the money of the term deposit. But in case the depositor expires before the maturity, either or survivor, there is Mr. A, there is Mr. B, Mr. A has expired, B is alive. In that case, no prepayment of the fixed term deposit will be allowed by the bank without the concurrence of the legal heirs of the deceased joint holder. Mind it, this is in case of expiry. In case of expiry, the surviving depositor wants the money back. In that situation, the legal heirs, you must be knowing, his son, suppose he is under the Hindu succession law, it can be son. Muslims, it can also be any male members, So that is depending on their succession law of the respective religion. It has to be seen who is the legal heirs. The legal heir can also be decided by the court. So the legal heirs also have to give their consent, and also the surviving depositor also has to sign, only then the payment will be made. So on maturity, the surviving joint holder will be paid the maturity proceeds, as we have already discussed. So the repayment of term or fixed deposit in joint names, another situation can be, it is in former or survivor mandate basis. Earlier it was either or survivor, now it can be former or survivor basis. Former means number one is former, remaining are survivors. Remaining, I mean, for one, former can be A, survivor can be B. So former or survivor, Mr. A's name is former, remaining B is the survivor names. So in a situation where withdrawal on maturity has to take place, by the former alone, he can withdraw on maturity because the clause is former or survivor. In case both the depositors are alive. Premature payment is there, in that situation, both have to sign. If former expires before the maturity of the deposit, the survivor can withdraw on maturity. No issue will be there. Premature withdrawal in case of death of one of the depositors, either former or the survivor. In that situation, the surviving depositor and the legal heirs of the deceased can withdraw. We have already discussed the legal heir part of it. Now, another situation is the renewal of overdue deposits. What is an overdue deposit? Suppose a deposit has been made for 1 year, term deposits. We are talking about term deposits. After 1 year, the depositor has not turned up to take the proceeds of the matured deposit. In that situation, what the bank should do? They cannot allow it to be in the same type of deposit, that is term deposit. If it remains in the same type of term deposit, then it will accrue interest. The interest will continue to accrue. It will not stop. So what they do, what the system of the banks do, they transfer that amount to a overdue deposit account or deposit at call account, or sometimes some banks call it mature deposit account. So there, once it goes, the fixed at the contracted rate, whatever the deposit was contracted at, that rate will stop. At this rate, that deposit will not earn the interest. So maturity renewal notice has to be sent by the banks. That notice, as per RBI guideline, should be sent 15 days in advance. The customer will respond. If he doesn't respond, sometimes the customer does not stay at the same address, or he's out of the town, he's not able to receive that notice, renewal notice. In that situation, the proceeds will be transferred to deposit at call account, as I just told you, because now that fixed deposit will stop earning the contracted interest rate. Now, there can be a situation in some of the banks, you find that auto renewal facility of term deposit receipt for the same periodicity. Suppose it was for 1 year, the system will renew it for another 1 year. For that also, in the beginning itself, in the account opening form, the banks are taking the consent of the depositor. And the rate of interest will be the current interest rate. What is the current interest rate means? Suppose a year back, the deposit was made for 6%. Now the interest rate is 6.5. So they will, this now renewed deposit will start earning 6.5%. But always as a banker, we insist the customer to give his consent in the beginning itself, whether he wants to renew it on maturity. No addition or deletion of the names of the joint account holder. In case the deposit account is in joint accounts, there can be a situation one of the joint account holders or may like to withdraw his name, or it is possible the depositor comes to us, both the depositors come to us, you add some name or delete some name. In that situation also, addition, deletion of the name of the joint account holder is permitted, but the condition is the amount should not be split, amount should not change, the amount should remain the same, and the duration of the original term deposit also to be maintained. For example, it is for 5 years, after 3 years they are coming for some addition or deletion, it has to remain, the term has to remain the same, the amount has to remain the same. Now NRE joint deposits, there is Reserve Bank of India guidelines that it can be opened by two or more NRIs. In case of NRIs joint deposits, it should always be in two NRIs names only. PIO is another term, that is person of Indian origin, NRI or PIO. So NRI or PIO, they have to open the account with NRI or PIO only, but RBI says they have given permission to the banks while they are circular dated 23rd June 2016 that even a resident holder can become joint account holder in that NRE account with the former or survivor clause. We have just discussed former or survivor clause in the previous slide. We have just discussed. So during the lifetime of the NRI PIO account holder, the resident relative can operate the account only on the basis of power of attorney of the NRI joint account holder. NRO accounts, non-resident ordinary, NREs, non-resident extender, those individuals who go abroad, they can open NRE account and NRO account also. NRO accounts may be held by non-residents jointly with residents. In fact, this NRO and NRE both are rupee accounts only, and that all these proceeds coming from abroad will be converted to rupee and then can be credited. However, whenever a person goes abroad, becomes NRI, non-resident individual, non-resident Indian, in that situation his SB account or his accounts which are already existing in his bank when he was a resident Indian, in that situation those accounts will be converted to NRO accounts. Other guidelines are regarding 15G and 15H. These are the two forms which individuals can submit to the bank. Suppose an individual who is having a term deposit, naturally on the term deposit, if the interest in one financial year is more than 10,000 rupees, bank will deduct some TDS and remit it to income tax authorities. But some individual can say that I am not liable to pay any tax, so please don't deduct TDS. In that situation, 15G and 15H can be submitted. 15G is for individual, 15H for senior citizens. Bank will give the acknowledgement, and also it is the guidelines of the Reserve Bank of India that SMS alert charges should be on actual usage basis. Bank should not earn any profit out of such kind of SMS alerts that the banks are sending to the customers. Whenever any customer logs into his internet banking account also, some SMS alert goes, any debit takes place, SMS alert goes. So these kind of banks should actual charge users charges only should be levied. So okay, thank you very much friends for being with me on this third session, unit 3. Thank you very much.